Runs with Courage, Chapter 13, Decision. That night I dreamt of Cousin. We stood together on a ridge in the forest of Hisapa. Sheer rock dropped beneath us into a valley below. All around us, tall pine trees reached into the sky like fingers. I could feel the earth on my bare toes and the warmth of the sun on my face. The wind began as a small breeze until it swelled into a chain of whispers, passing from one tree to the next. "Cousin," I said, "the trees speak. Listen." We both stood quietly until the wind moved to another part of the forest. "What was the message?" she asked. "Our ancestors say three things," I answered. "Strength, courage, and respect." "Those are good things," she said. "Yes," I nodded, and turned to embrace her, but she was gone. When I awoke, it was cold in our teepee. The fire was not yet lit, and I lay shivering beneath my sleeping skins. I could hear the wind blowing on the prairie, but it sounded different from the wind in my dream. There was something familiar in the sound, but I didn't know what it was. Then I sat upright, realizing what the sound was. A wagon! A wagon! Bear dashed through the teepee flap, confirming what I feared. I jumped up and followed him outside. From a distance, I could see a cloud of dust approaching. My stomach dropped. It was a white wagon. "Inside," I said, grabbing Bear by the hand, pulling him back into our teepee with me. Suddenly, I wanted to run to safety and take Bear with me and get away from the whites and the wagon and their school. Mother came in with a day's water and she had drawn from the pump. "I'll find someone to go get Father and Uncle," she said, hurrying back out. As the wagon pulled up to the stop near our teepee, I peeked through the teepee flap. Pinchfinger sat in the wagon, along with Pastor Huber and an agency official. I felt sick. In the council lodge, one of the uncles was trying to get them to meet in the council lodge. "No, we have come for Sarah. She will return with us," the agency official translated for my uncle. I didn't need translation. I could understand their angry white words on my own. Father and uncle appeared, and Pastor Huber stepped towards them. "We have come for Sarah. She must return to school. You know what will happen if she does not." I swallowed, knowing he was talking about the rations. "Sarah? Sarah?" Uncle said after the words had been translated. "There is no Sarah here." "I don't know what her Indian name is," the pastor said, spitting out the word Indian as if it were a rattlesnake inside his mouth. I stepped from behind the teepee flap and stood as tall as I could. "Sarah," Pinchfinger said, "stop this foolishness." "Not Sarah," Uncle yelled, using the white words. Then, more quietly, in Lakota, he said, There is only this girl, he pointed to me, Four Winds. Now Uncle spoke to me. "Four Winds, go back inside. We will settle this." I thought for a few mouthfuls of meat that had been added to our meal and the flour rations Mother had begun to receive. If I stayed, the whites would withhold the rations. If I stayed, my family would starve. "No," I said quietly in Lakota. "I will return," the agency official translated from my side. "That is exactly what is going to happen," Pastor Huber said, throwing an angry glance at Uncle. "Four Winds, it is your decision. If you choose to stay, we will fight," Uncle whispered. "I must return," I said. He nodded. I could hear Cousin's voice in the prairie wind. "Courage," she whispered. I pushed my tears away, gathering strength. I would return to being the white Indian girl. I would not be a bridge because I knew there was no bridges being built. I would return to keep my family from starving. I felt nothing as I was loaded into the white's wagon once again. Mother hugged me. I could feel her trembling. She pointed to where she knew the wota hung around my neck beneath my dress. I nodded back, clutching Bear's wooden rabbit in my palm. I knew how to keep them safe this time. They would not get burned. It was dark when we arrived at school. Once again, I followed Pinchfinger inside the building and up the stairs into the sleeping room where the other girls were. Prayers had already been said, and the girls were in their sleeping spaces. Once again, I could see white clothes laid out on the sleeping space for me. Just pretend like this unfortunate incident never happened," Pinchfinger said. I heard the words but wasn't listening. "A good thing that the snow has not yet fallen. My goodness, Sarah, you could have been hurt." "My name is not Sarah," I said quietly, using white words. She stopped talking, a surprised look on her face. "You do remember the language. I was afraid you had forgotten," she said, an air of relief in her voice. "My name is Four Winds," I said, "not Sarah." She peered at me. I gritted my teeth, prepared to be slapped for saying my Lakota name. I stared at her defiantly. I was stronger than her slaps, stronger than anything she could do to me. "It's time for prayers and bed," she said. I pulled my deerskin dress over my head and took the wotah from my neck, slipping it and the rabbit beneath my pillow. Pinchfinger turned to leave. "Wait," I said. "You will want to burn this," she said, "you will want to burn this." She turned to look at me. I handed her the dress. "It has been with the savages." "Oh, Sarah, don't make this difficult." She took the dress and stared at me, an almost pleading look in her eyes. I turned away from her and dressed in the white night clothes. I climbed into my sleeping space, trying to see the moon through the window. It had long since moved with the changing of the season, and I could no longer see it from where I lay. Carefully, I pulled at the seams of my pillow to make a small hole. Then I took the wooden rabbit and the wotah and tucked them safely inside. "Four Winds," Waxtal whispered from her space. "I am glad you are back." I said nothing.